السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وبعد. All praise due to Allah alone, we praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah the Almighty describes His word and His glorious book in the Quran in Surah Fussilat, chapter number 41, ayah number 41 and 42, by saying, وَإِنَّهُ لَكِتَابٌ عَزِيزٌ لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه تنزيل من حكيم حميد. Most surely, this is a mighty book. Falsehood shall not come to it from before it, nor from behind it. It is a revelation from the wise, the all worthy of praise. And in Surah Sad, chapter number 38, verse number 29, Allah the Almighty addresses His most beloved, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying concerning this book, كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليدبروا آياته وليتذكر أولو الألباب. This book which we have revealed unto you is full of blessings, is a blessed book. Why did He reveal it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ, for the believers to ponder over its verses, and for men of understanding that they may take heed, they may be mindful. The word تذكرون and تتذكرون and pretty much related to each other. Couple times in the Quran, the word tatadhakkarun, verses 16 times, Allah mentioned the word tadhakkarun, which means to be mindful, to take heed. And sometimes the word tadhakkarun is preceded with la'alla, la'allakum, la'allahum, which means perhaps, or that they may take heed, they may be mindful, that you may be mindful. There is also another word which is relating to at-tadhakkur, that is at-tafakkur, which is a deep pondering. Allah the Almighty cast the blame upon those who read or hear the Quran without pondering over its verses. He says in Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Will they not ponder over the Quran? Or the hearts have locks upon them. So the person who happens to read the Quran or hears the word of Allah, the blessed word of Allah in the Quran, and still does not ponder over it, nor benefit out of it, is similar to somebody who has a lock over his heart. And the heart here refers to one's intellect. He doesn't understand. He doesn't comprehend. So the Quran addresses people's intellects. The Quran is the only book which its author challenges the audience to bring anything similar to it. And from the very beginning, Allah the Almighty confirms that ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. That is the book. There is no doubt in it. There is no doubt concerning it. هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Then a few ayahs further, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah the Almighty challenges all mankind and the jinn altogether by saying, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّنْ مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Surah Al-Baqarah, the second chapter, verse number 23. If you're still in doubt concerning this Quran, so bring any chapter like it, any chapter. Doesn't have to be Al-Baqarah or An-Nisa or those long chapters. Any chapter. وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ. You may invite your witnesses, your assistants, your supporters, other than Allah, if you were true in your claim. Even the bestsellers, they have a second edition, and a third edition, and further editions. And in each edition, the author in the foreword says, I edited the following. I corrected the following. Because it's a human statement, even though it's a bestseller, other than the Quran. Because it is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It can't but to be perfect, but to be true. That's why Allah the Almighty, after inviting us to ponder and reflect over His word in the Quran, which is most perfect, He encourages people to contemplate and think for themselves. And He criticizes those who do not use their intellect to ponder over the Quran. So He says in Surah Al-Anfal, in ayah number 22, chapter number 8, إِنَّ شَرَّ الدَّوَابِّ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الصُّمُّ الْبُكْمُ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. Indeed, the worst of all creatures in the sight of Allah are الصم, deaf, البكم, dumb, لا يعقلون, they do not use their intellect. This ayah is not referring to animals, to cattle. No. It's referring to human beings whom Allah equipped with faculties of senses, yet they disable those faculties of senses. They have hearing, but they hear not. They have sharp eyesight, but they see not. They may be very intellectual in various science and fields of science and math, but when it comes to the truth, they're dumb. They're idiot. They do not use their intellect. Then, in Surah Al-Isra, Allah the Almighty says that chapter number 17, Surah Al-Isra, in ayah number 36, وَلَا تَقُفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا وَلَا تَقُفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ. Means, you shall not accept any information or take it for granted unless you verify it for yourself. I have given you the hearing, the eyesight, and al-fu'ad, which normally refers to the intellect, to the mind, all of that you will be asked about before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How did he utilize all these faculties of senses? Then again, Allah the Almighty discourages in the Quran, blindly following ancestral ways. Not to say this is how we found our parents or forefathers, and we do as we found them. You're responsible for your own self and for those who are under your guardianship. You're responsible to use your faculties of senses to comprehend the truth. Then, most importantly, act upon it. So he says in Surah Al-Ahzab, chapter number 33, ayah number 67, on the day of judgment, when the losers of the laymen, of the common people, will present false excuses before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying that we were not at fault, rather we just followed our leaders, our forefathers. So they say, وَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا إِنَّا أَطَعْنَا سَادَتَنَا وَكُبَرَاءَنَا فَأَضَلُّونَا السَّبِيلَ. They will present this excuse before Allah. It wasn't our fault because we followed our leaders. We followed our elders and our superior ones. So they led us astray. But Allah equipped you with the intellect. And he demanded you to use your intellect in order to comprehend the truth and decide on your own. Then Allah the Almighty confirms the fact that not because most of people have chosen something that indicates it is the truth. Rather it is, or it could be on the contrary. He says Azza wa Jalla in Surah Al-An'am, ayah number 116, وَإِن تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَن فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّكَ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. If you were to listen to the vast majority, to most of those who are living on earth, to most of people, they shall mislead you. They shall take you away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a very interesting ayah, which shows us that not because the vast majority of people are following certain ideology or adopting certain theory or belief, that means that they may be right. You have to think on your own. Think for yourself. Ponder and reflect. Then decide, because no one will be held accountable on your behalf. In a couple examples, I would like to shed some light upon the concept of التذكر والتفكر في القرآن. Allah the Almighty and the Quran is a book of reasoning. And one of the miraculous natures of the Quran is reasoning. It doesn't simply impose on people or on the audience certain belief without explaining why. And the explanation is stemming from reasoning and logic. Look into this beautiful ayah of Surah Al-Anbiya that addresses those who may take other than Allah as God or take other deities besides Allah the Almighty. He says, addressing one's intellect, لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا آلِهَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهُ لَفَسَدَتَا فَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَرْشِ عَمَّا يَصِفُونَ. I want you to imagine, before I explain the meaning of this ayah, having a vehicle in this very heavy traffic in Manila, a car with two steering wheels, with two active drivers, driving and controlling their wheels simultaneously at the same time. Is it possible? Could it happen? No way. It's impossible. At the first intersection, when one driver decides to swerve right and the other decides to go left, what's going to happen? Split the vehicle. Allah the Almighty is utilizing the same logic by saying, لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا. If there had been in them, in both the heavens and the earth, any God besides Allah, most certainly both would have been ruined and in a state of disorder. Two gods with two authorities. One decides something and the other decides entirely the opposite. As a result of that, with two omnipotent, most powerful deities, one of them will destroy the other, or both will destroy the creation, the heavens and the earth, and both the heavens and the earth will be in a state of disorder. But this is not happening, which indicates logically that there is one driver, one controller of all affairs. That is the only Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Could that Lord be in the form of a human being, or have human and have divine under any circumstances? Again, Allah the Almighty proves that this is impossible logically and through the means of reasoning, and invites people to think, to ponder over that. So in Surah Al-Ma'idah, chapter number 5, ayah number 75, and I hope you're writing down the ayahs for your own record. This is a beautiful ayah. And through this ayah, you can bring many non-Muslims into Islam simply through reasoning and logic. He says, Azza wa Jal, مَا الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ مَرْيَمَ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ وَأُمُّهُ صِدِّيقَةٌ كَانَا يَأْكُلَانِ الطَّعَامِ. End of quote. What does it mean? Allah is addressing those who argue concerning the nature of Jesus, the son of Mary, and whether he is God or son of God, have anything to do with God other than being human or having dual personalities. He says, مَا الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ مَرْيَمَ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ. Jesus, the son of Mary, is not but a messenger whom many messengers before him have come and left. وَأُمُّهُ, and what is the status of his mother? صِدِّيقَةٌ. This is how we revere Mary, peace be upon her, in Islam. She was truthful and a chaste woman. Jesus, the son of Mary, and his mother, كَانَا يَأْكُلَانِ الطَّعَامِ. Look at the divine way of reasoning. That both of them used to eat. Both of them used to eat. Means what? They were dependent. And if one is in need to eat, then he or she is also in need to drink. And what happens after eating and drinking? The biological process, digestion, then excretion. Can you imagine God is in need to pass urine or answer the call of nature or rush to the bathroom or suffers of diarrhea or constipation? Can you imagine God who is hungry and starving? And by the way, that is also stated in the Bible, in the New Testament, where it says that Jesus, peace be upon him, was traveling with his companions, with his disciples, and he was extremely hungry. So he saw a fig tree from a distance. He approached the fig tree, but there was no fruits. There was no fig. He hit its branches with his stick, but it didn't bear any fruits. So he cursed the tree. When, as a reasonable person, a logical person, when I read this in any book that says this person is God, I would say, definitely this is not true. That doesn't make any sense. So the Creator doesn't know whether the tree which he created bears fruits or not. And he is so disabled to make it bear fruits. And why would he need to eat? We're all his dependents. Whenever we're hungry, we call upon him to feed us. Is it possible for God, for the sustainer, to be in need, to be hungry and to be starving, to get angry at a tree which he created because it was not as he expected it, bearing fruits? This whole thing doesn't make any sense. That contradicts the simple logic. This is what Allah the Almighty have stated in a very short and brief statement when he said, كان يأكلان الطعام.
Him and his mother used to eat. انظر كيف نبين لهم الآيات ثم انظر أن يؤفكون.
Look and consider how we explain our ayat and communications, how we prove the case to them, and then look again, behold, how they are turned away and deluded from the truth. So there is no excuse for people who happen to read the Quran, because the message is very clear and obvious.
كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليدبروا آياته وليتذكر أولو الألباب.
This is the main purpose, to ponder over its ayat, and that people of understanding may take heed, may be mindful.
We said the word تذكرون is mentioned in the Quran 16 times.
Sometimes in the form of لعلكم تذكرون, that you may be mindful.
لعلهم, they may be mindful.
Sometimes in the form أفلا تذكرون,
will you not then take heed?
And sometimes قليلا ما تذكرون,
little is that what you take heed.
The summary of all of that, Allah is inviting us to reflect and to ponder, then to take heed, to be mindful. For the sake of time, I chose a few ayat out of the 16 different verses scattered all over the Quran, beginning from Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 121, chapter number 2. Close to the end of the verse, because it's a long verse, long ayah, Allah the Almighty says,
وَاللَّهُ يَدْعُو إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ وَالْمَغْفِرَةِ بِإِذْنِهِ وَيُبَيِّنُ آيَاتِهِ لِلنَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ.
And Allah invites to heaven and to forgiveness by His leave. And He makes clear His communications to His servants, to people, that they may take heed, that they may be mindful. So Allah is asking us to be mindful of what? To do tadhakkur and tadabbur of what? That every call of Allah upon us is towards giving us salvation, is in order to make us successful in both lives, in this life and in the hereafter. Even if this call is concerning do's and do not do's. So whenever there is haram and halal, simply following the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this regard is in order to make you saved, to make you successful. وَيُبَيِّنُ آيَاتِهِ لِلنَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. Because He calls people unto what?
Al-Jannah,
heaven. وَالْمَغْفِرَةِ بِإِذْنِهِ, and forgiveness by His leave. So the believers, when it comes to any communication from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they do not take it lightly. Every time Allah the Almighty says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, He is calling upon the believers. So they lend an attentive ear, an attentive heart, because they perceive the call as Allah is addressing them, because they consider themselves of the believers.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to another episode of Let's Talk.
I could agree that institutional racism does exist. To be precise, we should define institutional racism, and that is hidden or non-apparent racism within an organization or an institution. I have witnessed it, maybe in half Saudi. My last name is Arab, So when I moved to the States back in 2002, after the incidents of 9/11, I did face some racism.
I think it can be what you do, but in the sense of without thinking. The things you do naturally without having to stop and think, that just come out.
Okay.
You know, this innate nature of you, and how you think and the way you see things.
We can get your insights on the two different countries, inshallah, further on into this conversation. Mm-hmm. Mamadou, if I can come to you, what's your thoughts on institutional racism, especially in the UK? Do you think it's really prevalent there?
The way we live, it's kind of a combination of two things. Our language, and then what we believe in. So if we have got a language without believing in something, so it will be useless. So we have to get like both things going together.
I'm calling your name. Oh, Allah.
In the following ayat, such as in Surah Al-An'am, chapter number 6, ayah number 152, there is a couple of ayat ended up with لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ تَشْكُرُونَ تَذَكَّرُونَ تَتَّقُونَ تَعْقِلُونَ, that you may be mindful, that you may have a better understanding, that you may be righteous. After a list of commands, in this ayah 152, chapter number 6, Allah the Almighty says,
وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا مَالَ الْيَتِيمِ إِلَّا بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ أَشُدَّهُ وَأَوْفُوا الْكَيْلَ وَالْمِيزَانَ بِالْقِسْطِ لَا نُكَلِّفُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا وَإِذَا قُلْتُمْ فَاعْدِلُوا وَإِذَا قُلْتُمْ فَاعْدِلُوا وَلَوْ كَانَ ذَا قُرْبَى وَبِعَهْدِ اللَّهِ أَوْفُوا ذَلِكُمْ وَصَّاكُمْ بِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ.
So the ayah and the quote ended up with لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. Wait a minute, I need to go back to the beginning of the ayah. To do tadhakkur, to do tadabbur, to be mindful of what Allah has enjoined to me in this ayah. He says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا مَالَ الْيَتِيمِ إِلَّا بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Do not approach the property of the orphan except in the best manner until he or she attained maturity. Then he says, وَأَوْفُوا الْكَيْلَ وَالْمِيزَانَ بِالْقِسْطِ. Give full measure and weight with justice. Then another command, four beautiful teachings in this ayah. When you speak, be just, though it be against a relative. If you're called upon to deliver a shahada, a testimony, even if your shahada, your testimony, will be against one of your relatives, against your own parents, or against your own self, say the truth and nothing but the truth. This is a communication of Allah in this ayah. Then finally he says, and fulfill Allah's covenant. This he has enjoined you with, that you may be mindful. If you stick to what he said, if you fulfill the teachings and the commands of Allah in this ayah, then you're mindful of his ayat. Then you are one of the successful ones. And those teachings guarantee success of the entire community, whether the individual or the community, al-jama'ah. Then when it comes to the concept of the unseen, so we stated first how Allah proves logically his lordship, his oneness, and he's the only one who's worthy of worship. And then again, he calls upon us that whenever he communicates any message unto us, we should accept it with full submission and ponder over it. Then, when it comes to the unseen, the world of the unseen. What is going to happen after this life? None of us have an access to it. None of us knows how would the resurrection take place. But because we believe in Allah and He is unseen to us, we also believe in His communication. But Allah the Almighty does not want us to believe blindly. He provides us with the reasoning. He provides us with the reference that makes all the sense. So He says in Surah Al-A'raf, that is chapter number 7, ayah number 57. And after this session, brothers and sisters, I would like for you to read the tafsir of all those 16 ayahs. And every ayah ended up with, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ أَوْ قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. Because there is a very valuable message in these ayat that Allah wanted us to ponder over them. So He says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي يُرْسِلُ الرِّيَاحَ بُشْرًا بَيْنَ يَدَيْ رَحْمَتِهِ حتى إذا أقلت سحابا ثقالا سقناه لبلد ميت فأنزلنا به الماء فأخرجنا به من كل الثمرات كذلك نخرج الموتى لعلكم تذكرون. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the Meccan pagans, one of the Meccan chiefs, an unbelieving person, extremely rich, a bunch of kids. He picked up a rotten bone, decayed, and he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Ya Muhammad, do you claim that your Lord will be able to revive this rotten bone after it have decayed?" Then he rubbed it between his fingers and it turned into dust and powder. Now the man is speaking physically, holding something tangible in his hand. This is a bone, decayed, decomposed. Then he rubbed it and it turned into dust. Do you say that your Lord will be able to revive this dead bone, cover it with flesh, and revive its owner and bring him back to life to be held accountable for reckoning? What was the answer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He said, most certainly he will, and he will cause you to die. Then he will resurrect you and he will send you to hell if you do not believe in that. Allah the Almighty confirmed that by the end of Surah Yasin when He says, وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقَهُ قَالَ مَنْ يُحْيِي الْعِظَامَ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ. When He gave the example of the bone and He said, who can bring back to life this decayed bone? قُلْ. Allah the Almighty gave the answer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to all of us so that we can communicate it to those who do not believe in the resurrection and in life after death. قُلْ يُحْيِيهَا الَّذِي أَنْشَأَهَا أَوَّلَ مَرَّةِ. The one who gave it life in the very first place is able to bring it back to life. So this ayah of Surah Al-A'raf is given a parable. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His blessings, send the wind, bringing about a laden cloud, then this laden cloud would keep moving until it comes on top of a barren land. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order the laden cloud to drop its rain. What would the rain do to the barren land? Revive it and bring forth fruits and vegetations. In Texas, where I used to live, we drive for maybe hundreds of miles, and you come across huge fields. Because I traveled a lot, I teach here and there, so I travel throughout the four seasons. Subhanallah, I see the land, miles and miles, where it is gray, dry, no life whatsoever. Then when the farmer sow the seed and Allah drops down the heavy rain, it produces the fruits and vegetations. It turned to be green. Then in another trip, it becomes yellow and straw, then dry again. This cycle of reviving the barren land and producing the living out of the dead is a typical example and a perfect demonstration of how Allah the Almighty is going to bring us back from the state of death to revive us to be a kafir, to demonstrate how the hereafter will take place. So Allah the Almighty, through reasoning, is giving us an example of what is tangible, to prove what is not tangible, to prove the unseen without being able to visualize it. By the end, it is very logical that Allah the Almighty says, كَذَلِكَ نُخْرِجُ الْمَوْتَى لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. Thus, we bring out the dead. We bring them back to life. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. That you may be mindful. That you may take heed. This life is short and brief. 60, 70, 80. Then after that, death. And you stay in the grave for, God knows, 1,000, 2,000 years, could be more, could be less. Then we will be revived. من الأجداث إلى ربهم ينسلون. Then there will be an eternal life, either in heaven, may Allah make us all amongst its dwellers, or in hell, may Allah protect us against it. The Quran is also full of parables, amthal, about 40 beautiful examples that Allah the Almighty has given in the Quran. One of the most beautiful examples is how he gave the parable of the goodly word to the goodly tree. And the goodly word, he refers to the greatest word, the word of salvation. La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah. He says in Surah Ibrahim, chapter number 14, ayah number 24, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس لعلهم يتذكرون. لعلهم يتذكرون. I heard that word before. In order to be mindful, go back. I want to read the ayah from the beginning, 24 and 25. Oh, have you not considered how Allah sets forth a parable of the goodly word, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah? How goodly is that word? It is exactly like a goodly tree whose roots are firm underground and whose branches are very high and fruitful. They reach the clouds. وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ تُؤْتِي أُكُلَهَا كُلَّ حِينٍ بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهَا. Yielding its fruits in every season by the leave of its Lord. Allah the Almighty sets forth parables for people in order to be mindful. This is how good is that word. It's like having a garden. It's like having a goodly tree that produces fruits throughout the entire year and every season. Its roots are very firm, deep underground. Its branches are very high, reaching the clouds, reaching the heaven. Then another beautiful stop with this time, أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ, that's a rhetorical question. Will you not then take heed? Will you not then be mindful? It's like Allah the Almighty is blaming the audience. After all, you're still lagging behind. He still do not pay attention to what Allah the Almighty is saying. In Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, particularly ayah number 17 and 18. Before ayah number 17, Allah the Almighty listed and counted some of His countless blessings upon us. Then the conclusion of this reminder was in ayah number 17 when He says, أَفَمَنْ يَخْلُقُ كَمَنْ لَا يَخْلُقُ أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ أَفَمَنْ يَخْلُقُ كَمَنْ لَا يَخْلُقُ In Arabic, that's called سُؤَالٌ إِسْتِنْكَارِ. And in English, it is called a negative question, which means its answer is already known. So why are we presenting the question? Is to confirm a fact, to establish the truth through presenting what is known as a negative question in the English grammar. أَفَمَنْ يَخْلُقُ After Allah counted some of His countless blessings, He said, Subhanallah, is He then who creates like He who creates not? How could you treat the Creator like the creation? How could you treat the one who's created as if He is the Creator? أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ Will you not then take heed and be mindful? Then automatically the following ayah is وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَغَفُورٌ رَّحِيمٌ Even though Allah the Almighty just referred to a few of His blessings, of His countless blessings, then He invited us to be mindful and to take heed. He came to say, by the way, most surely, if you would count Allah's favors and blessings upon you, you will never be able to number them. They are simply beyond count. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ Verily, Allah is the all-forgiving, most merciful. So He is addressing the believers and the non-believers alike. But most specifically, He is addressing those who enjoy all the blessings of Allah, yet they do not give thanks to Him. What happens if every morning you open your door and you find a nice gift, in a nice gift wrap, you find your provision for the day, in addition to some cash, in addition to some gifts, you take all of that and you go home, you eat it, you enjoy the gift, and you don't even bother to say, I wonder who delivered the package? Can you imagine that? How would you judge such person whom every morning opens his front door to collect the provision without even bothering to ask? Who sent it? Who delivered it? This is very much similar to one who is enjoying his countless blessings. Meanwhile, he worships other than Him. He gives thanks and gratitude to other than Him. That's why he used أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ The rhetorical question. Will you then not understand and ponder? Will you then not take heed? How much time? I understand it's Maghrib time. So shall we pause for the Adhan or how are you going to do it? Yani, how much time do I have? I know that you don't like to be asked questions. 10 minutes? Oh, okay, we'll make it before that, inshallah azza jal. The subject of at-tadhakkur and at-tafakkur is very deep. A single ayah of these 16 ayat can take us a whole day or so that we will give it its due rights. But we're just shedding some light upon the general meaning of at-tadhakkur and its relationship to at-tafakkur. What is tafakkur? At-tafakkur is a deeper thinking and pondering. And Shaykh al-Islam or the student of Shaykh al-Islam, Ibn al-Qayyim, may Allah have mercy on him in his beautiful book, which is known as The Benefits or Al-Fawaid, says that the relationship between at-tadhakkur and at-tafakkur is a direct correlation. It's like a polarization. التذكر pollinates التفكر, and التفكر pollinates التذكر. When a person spares some time to think deeply and ponder over the creation of Allah, and that leads him to magnify and honor Allah the Almighty through recognizing some of His creation. As a result of that, that will pollinate and activate in him the quality of at-tadhakkur. So whenever he does tadhakkur, that pollinates the quality of tafakkur, and he keeps in the circle of tafakkur and tadhakkur, which is among is the greatest acts of worship. As Allah the Almighty invited the believers repeatedly in the Quran to do. So he goes back and forth between Subhanallah walhamdulillah. Subhanallah, Allah is above all what they ascribe to him. Allah is free from any imperfection. That happens as a result of at-tafakkur. When you keep thinking about a little creation, Allah the Almighty addresses those who worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hajj by saying, those whom you invite instead of Allah or besides Allah, لَنْ يَخْلُقُوا ذُبَابًا وَلَوْ اجْتَمَعُوا لَهُ. They can never even create a fly. They are unable to create a mosquito. If all of those whom you worship instead of Allah gather efforts and hands together to create a fly, they will never be able to. Not only that, وَإِنْ يَسْلُبْهُمُ الذُّبَابُ شَيْئًا لَا يَسْتَنْقِذُوهُ مِنْهُ ضَعُفَ الطَّالِبُ وَالْمَطْلُوبُ. If I have a glass of drink in front of me, while busy talking, that a fly came on my cup and took a dip, a sip, or tasted my drink. For that fly, this is provision. This is food or drink. For me, I'm angry with the fly. Even if you capture the fly, can you take back what it took from you? Can you extract the drink or the food which it took from you? You can never do that. ضَعُفَ الطَّالِبُ وَالْمَطْلُوبُ. Both are weak. The seeker and the one who seeks. Who's the seeker? Me. I'm seeking the fly to capture the fly to take back my property. And the seeked one is the fly. We're both weak. Whether the human being with his intellect, with his science, with his advanced technology, or the weak fly, you think that the fly is weak. So why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a couple parables in the Quran and made several mentions of the Quran to the fly? This is the most insignificant creation, you think? It is very sophisticated. So what about the Creator himself? Subhanallah. وَإِنْ تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Surah An-Nahl as well, chapter number 16 still, ayah number 90, and you should never forget the number of this ayah. Ayah number? The brothers seem to be very sleepy, subhanallah. What did you have for lunch? Chapter number 16, Surah An-Nahl. What kind of book is it that Allah once names the whole chapter An-Nahl? Nahl means what? The honeybees. Who? And another chapter he calls it An-Naml. Ants. And a third, Al-Fil, the elephant. It is not about the size. It's about the miraculous nature in creating such creation. Whether it's an ant, a honeybee, a mosquito, a fly, or an elephant. Subhanallah. The whole book from cover to cover, لا ريب فيه, and he invites us to ponder over it, that we may be mindful, we may take heed. This ayah number 90 of Surah An-Nahl, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anh says, it is the most comprehensive ayah in the entire Quran. Because of its rich nature, Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, the fifth rightly guided caliph, ordered all the speakers and the imams to recite this ayah in every Friday sermon. The entire deen from cover to cover is listed in this ayah. All the books of fiqh, the adab and etiquette and manners compiled and comprised in this ayah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. Well, surely Allah enjoins the doing of justice and the doing of good to all, and the giving to the kindred, to the relatives, assisting them financially. And he forbids all indecent acts, al-fahsha, all evil, al-munkar, and al-baghi, oppression and zulm, and rebelliousness. Then he says, ya'idhukum, he admonishes you that you may be mindful. This ayah by itself is a lecture, is a session to address. What does Allah command? All His commands revolve between al-adl wal-ihsan wa ita'i dhil-qurba, these kind deeds. And what does He forbid? He forbids only evil, indecency, and injustice. So whatever Allah has forbidden blindly is evil. And whatever Allah has commanded blindly is definitely good, whether we know a direct reason for it or not. Then he invites us to ponder over that, to examine that, so that as a result of that, we become mindful of his presence. Unfortunately, we're running out of time, but perhaps I can take one more ayah. I have listed a couple more ayat, but for the sake of time and in order to be able to pray Maghrib in Jama'ah, inshallah. One of the most important ayat in the Quran with regards to at-tadhakkur, which we can never miss, is ayah number 49 of Surah Al-Zariyat, chapter number 41. This ayah is revealed, as you all know, that since the Quran was revealed more than 1400 years ago, more than science was able to know what is bacteria and what is virus, more than we're able to figure out how to see and magnify minute objects via the electronic microscope. Allah the Almighty says, وَمِن كُلِّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَا زَوْجَيْنِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ, which means, and of everything we have created pairs, that you may be mindful. Keep thinking about it forever. We've created of everything pairs, as-sama, al-ard, the heavens and the earth, the sun, the moon, human beings and the jinn, males and females, pairs, even the plants, males and females, even the bacteria, gram-positive and gram-negative. This is amazing. Of everything we've created pairs, day and night, good and evil, humans and the jinn. He can keep going on forever. Why? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. So we're supposed to reflect upon that. We're supposed to take heed. We're supposed to study that. Muslims, more worthy than anybody else, are supposed to invest in that field scientifically, along with belief, to confirm the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the following ayah, which is number 50, chapter number 41, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنِّي لَكُمْ مِنْهُ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. You know the word firru means, al-farar means fleeing. And when you flee, when you fly away, when you run away from something, it is because you fear it. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one whom, when you fear Him, you fly and you flee unto Him, not away from Him. فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ, so flee unto Allah from His punishment into His reward. Fleeing from the disobedience and disbelief into obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to be saved. Brothers and sisters, may Allah grant us the quality of at-tadhakkur, at-tadabbur, and at-tafakkur, and remove the run and rust from above our hearts so that we can reflect upon the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jubair ibn Mut'im, one of the Meccan pagans, when he came after the battle of Badr to ransom his son who was a prisoner of war, he said, when I came to Al-Madinah, I heard Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was reciting of Surah At-Tur. And in this surah, when I heard those ayat, كَادَ قَلْبِي أَن يَطِيرُ, my heart was about to fly out of my chest. This is a non-believer. But when he heard this ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not only addressing him or me or only certain people, he's addressing everyone, all audience. أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ أَمْ خَلَقُوا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ بَلْ لَا يُقِنُونَ. Have they been created without a creator? Or perhaps they have created themselves? These are logical questions that when we throw at the non-believers, the atheists, or those who worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the non-practicing Muslims, they should bring us back to the straight track. As Allah the Almighty says, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنِّي لَكُمْ مِنْهُ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. Therefore, flee to Allah, towards Allah. Surely I'm a plain warner to you from Him. May Allah the Almighty guide us to what is best. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our hearts to accept the truth. May Allah increase the level of our iman. May Allah pardon us and forgive us our sins. May Allah unite this ummah and render it back to His deen. May Allah protect and support our oppressed and weak brothers and sisters in Palestine, especially during this very hard time, and our brothers and sisters in Asham in general, in Pakistan, in Afghanistan, in Burma, in Kashmir, and everywhere. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.